Hello and welcome to Unit 7. This is the first of two units in which the ideas of fractals and scaling are applied to particular types of complex systems. In this unit, we'll look at scaling in metabolic systems, and in the next unit, we'll look at scaling in urban systems, in cities. I'll begin this unit by presenting Kleiber's law, which is an empirical relationship between an organism's body mass and its metabolic rate. I'll then present the West-Brown-Enquist theory that posits a mechanism or an explanation for why this relationship is true. And we'll then look at some other scaling relationships that follow from this main metabolic scaling result. This unit also includes interviews with a couple of researchers doing work in metabolic scaling. So let's get started by looking at Kleiber's law. So our starting point in this unit will be to think about Kleiber's law. And Kleiber's law is a statement about how metabolic rate is related to body mass. So let me say a little bit about this and then we'll look at some data. So metabolic rate refers to the rate at which an organism consumes resources, food, or equivalently the rate at which it generates heat, because that's where the food that it consumes, that energy, ultimately goes into heat. So metabolic rate could just be how many calories the creature needs to consume in a day in order to live, in order to carry out its basic life functions, whatever those are. And then the question is, how is that related to body mass? Well, we would expect that bigger creatures need to eat more because there's more of them to keep alive. But the question is, what is this relationship? And so that's what Kleiber started to look at in, I think, maybe around 1930, 1940, sometime in the 30s. And subsequently, and he discovered a certain regular relationship, and subsequent to that, more data was gathered, and this relationship proved to be rather robust. So here's a version of what this looks like. This is from a more recent paper. I'll put the reference down here. I think it's West and Brown, I believe, are the two authors. So let me draw these labels more clearly. What we have here on a logarithmic scale is mass. And on the vertical axis is metabolic rate. Maybe I'm allergic to this color Sharpie. I don't know. Sorry about that. Okay, so we have mass on a log scale and metabolic rate on a log scale. And it's a little hard to see, but there are lots of data points, a bunch here, and many, many, many in here. So let's focus on this portion of the graph first. These dots, I know they just look like a cloud. These are lots and lots of mammals. So take a mammal, weigh the mammal to get its mass, watch how much it eats, or do something maybe a little more sophisticated than that, and you can get the metabolic rate. And so there's this pretty strong linear relationship. This data point here is an elephant, and this here is a shrew, one of the smallest mammals. Here, these are cells. So this is an average mammalian cell, a mitochondria. These are resting cells. And let's ignore sort of those two points. But the main result is that there's a linear relationship here and a linear relationship here. And we've learned that a linear relationship on a log-log plot is an indication of some sort of power law or scale-free behavior. So we expect that there's some scaling relationship. More careful statistics has been done on this, and it's been shown that, yes, this is indeed very well described by a power law. These two power laws have the same slope, but they'll have different intercepts. But the slope is the same, and it's very, very close to 3/4. So this poses a number of questions, and that's often the case, I think, with power law research. One starts doing just gathering data and doing some empirical work and noticing, hey, there's a pattern. There's a pattern here. This seems to fit a power law. And then from that, a number of questions flow. So I want to, before we dig into the theory, say a little bit about other shapes that this graph could have had but didn't. So first of all, note that for a given mass, there's a relatively small range of metabolic rates. The world maybe didn't have to be that way, or certainly generically a relationship like this doesn't have to fall along a line at all. It could be the case that you have creatures that are the same size, but with very different metabolic rates. You'd still expect some upward trend, I would guess, because big creatures need more food to keep their mass alive. But maybe, you know, it could have been that this data looked like this. In other words, a big cloud around this, so that it doesn't really seem to fit a line at all, any curve at all, right? So that this would mean that this mass, you could have a creature like this, and maybe this would be some really some creature that sleeps all the time and really doesn't do much because it doesn't need a lot of food. And maybe this is a creature that lives in the snow and runs around all the time, so it needs an enormous amount of food, but they happen to be the same amount, same size. So there's no reason, at least, you know, sort of maybe a priori, to expect that these would fall along a curve at all, right? They could just be a big spread of this. So additionally, the fact that they do fall along what appears to be a curve or a line is noteworthy. But then it turns out that the fact that these slopes are the same is also interesting. So it could be that we looked at some data, and instead of this being a line, it had some concavity like this, or, you know, something like that. Who knows? All right. So it doesn't. When you have a bunch of data, it doesn't automatically have to fall on a line at all. And of course, it doesn't automatically. If there is a line or a curve, that curve doesn't have to be straight. So this is sort of a remarkable or noteworthy thing that makes one pay attention to, hey, wait, what's going on here? We're seeing a straight line on a log-log plot. We didn't have to see that. You don't always see that, but we did in this case. And so that means there's some sort of power law relationship. And then we've also learned that power laws are scale-free. So that's a little bit surprising, because maybe that says in some sense shrews are scaled up or scaled down versions of elephants. I mean, they don't look the same, but when you think about their metabolic rate, maybe there's some similarity across here, some similar processes that are working across many scales. We see a similar scaling here for cells of many, many different sizes. So that suggests to us that there's something interesting going on and something that is scale-free, some maybe sort of broader principle that's connecting all of these data points. So Kleiber's law was pretty well established as a relationship between metabolic rate and mass. What was lacking was a clear mechanistic explanation for why this might be so. And the West-Brown-Enquist scaling theory, which I'll get to in a few videos, provides an explanation for why we'd expect to see this linear behavior, and more interestingly, why we end up with this slope of 3/4 and not something else. So that's an overview of Kleiber's law that sets the stage for what's going to follow. In the next couple of videos, I'm going to talk about scaling a little bit more generally, and we'll think about surface area to volume ratios and see that that doesn't explain this relationship. And then we'll look at the West-Brown-Enquist theory and see how thinking about this as a fractal network can provide a good potential explanation for why we see an exponent of 3/4.